Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 27. Before we get into anything, we're going to pass it along to Jeremy for the BIPCOT no-gov license.
2 weeks in a row, I'm proud of you. the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT no-gov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
Nice. So today we're going to discuss a little bit of current events, what's going on in the Middle East and a little bit in Europe, I think, Eastern Europe, regarding the refugees and immigration and, you know, what is the, you know, is there an immorality present? Why are they fleeing? You know, do people just go for no reason or is there a reason that they're leaving? And if there is a reason, what is the reason, right? Could it be that they're fleeing from a, you know, drone bomb war zone, you know, hell on earth, U.S. creation? Could it be?
No.
Does that have anything to do with our invasions and occupations and assassinations?
It's the Muslim invasion on the white man's land. That's all it is.
It's all about racism, right? So, so we'll get into that. So the way I look at it, I mean, it's kind of funny that you know, the blame is on these people who are fleeing, like you know, you know, this country's not going to let them in. You know, we only have this much capacity. Whereas the real immorality is like, wait a minute, why are they fleeing? Like, I think people I saw a great meme today. It's like, so why is Obama not in jail yet? I mean, it's really amazing how, you know, this war on terror has been going on for, you know, what, like going on 15 years now, right? 14 years. And it's just like commonplace. It's like, you know what? We're at war. It's just normal now. You know, people, they don't bat an eye, and
it's an occupation.
It's like, so what's for lunch?
It's an occupation to secure oil, man.
Right. Yes.
And that's not that's not tinfoil hat. That is fact.
Well, gold, oil, and drugs, right? God.
Yeah. God.
I think the immigrant crisis can be boiled down to this like cocktail situation. You have, you know. You have Germany, France, England, Norway, Sweden, all these countries, all these huge welfare states are getting flooded with immigrants right now because it's like, hey, you can just, as soon as you cross the border, you basically get all this free shit. So you have, that's one part of this cocktail. The other part is you have either a tyrannical warlord that was put in place by the fascist cartel bankers, you know, to control the area, and they don't, you know, they've made life as terrible as possible, or you're getting drone bombed by the United States government. And,
some nice choices there.
And, you know, you're in a debt. Would you rather be in a desert or in a forest? Would you rather be in Syria or in Germany? Honestly, ask yourself that hard question. I don't care if you grew up in Germany or you grew up in Syria, just as an outside on the sideline looking in. Where would you rather live? Syria, Lebanon, Kurdistan, wherever. Where would you rather be on the globe? Would you rather be in Germany or would you rather be there? So you have this huge, like, I'm sure there's people that are leaving for different reasons. You know, but it's hard to argue with crossing a border and getting free healthcare for your children when you literally don't even have a pot to piss in. Like, you literally, that you're fighting for survival. So it's you can see the case. I mean, is it moral? No, but
you
that's just a knee-jerk reaction for every parent to want to, you know, secure their offspring.
Yeah, well, I mean, I would say I'm sure there are some people that are running for that reason, you know, for the reason of the quote unquote free stuff. But to me, that, I don't know, because I look at the situation here in the great old USSA with the immigration issue here. And, you know, I think we might have touched on this in a previous episode. I know I'm pretty sure I said something about it. The fact that when I hear stuff like that to me sounds like the conservative argument where they're just like, oh, everybody's here for the free stuff. And it's like, well, no, some of them are, but a lot of them are just trying to escape horrible, horrible, horrible conditions. And the quote unquote free stuff that they may or may not get is actually just like a side bonus. You know, I think this particular so-called crisis would probably have more to do with people just running for their lives, literally, because over the past few years, I think it may be stretching back 5 or 6 years now at this point, there's been an influx in, you know, the countries that you mentioned, Dave, you know, Germany, France, Sweden, Norway, England. There's been this influx of people from the Middle East, but it's been, I think I heard one of the shows, I think it was the Tom Wood show I was listening to today when he had Daniel McAdams on. And for the past few years, the asylum seekers and or refugees that have tried to relocate to other countries have come, like, you know, in order of like a ranking, it's been Iraq, Afghanistan, and Syria. Like, there's people coming from other places, obviously, but those are the top three. And what do those three have in common? They may have been bombed to shit by the U.S. government. Just maybe, you know, so it's completely unstable. People are afraid for their lives because they have no idea if somebody's going to come, you know, something's going to come dropping out of the sky, you know, supposedly to get one bad person, but with the collateral damage that the U.S. government is willing to accept, you never know that you could just be walking down the street and you could get blown to bits because they were after one other guy who may or may not have been hiding out next door to you or two doors down from you or something. So a lot of these people seem to be, you know, that would make sense to me that they're just fleeing, because why would you want to stay there? I mean, even if even if you don't are not looking for the free stuff, or you want the free stuff, or even if it's just a matter of, you know, it's your homeland. Well, if your homeland's getting bombed to shit, wouldn't you, you know, if somebody was over here bombing the ever living hell out of the East Coast, I'm pretty sure I would want to relocate somewhere else with my family, you know? So it's like, I can't really blame them. So when it comes to the moral argument, I have a hard time getting a bearing on morals at all when it comes to this, because it's almost, it becomes a matter of survival. Now, on the flip side of this, I did hear, I think I might have heard Molyneux talking about something with a caller on one of his shows about this. And he, of course, put up a different argument, which I know a lot of people will attack him as a statist for. And I can kind of see it, but because his argument was, you know, when Japan got the ever-living crap kicked out of it by the United States government, you know, first everything was firebombed, then they dropped the nuclear bombs. But when that happened, did all the Japanese flee? Did they all rush to China? No, they stayed put and rebuilt.
Japanese get killed inside of China at that point.
Well, yes, but well, still, like,
China but Japan owned most of China. I get your point.
Or anywhere. That's just the closest place to them that, you know, happened to be China. But like, did they flee anywhere else? Did they start seeking asylum? No, they stayed there. They rebuilt, and they moved on.
But that's, you know, but that stimulated their economy.
Well, yeah, broken windows everywhere, baby.
There's Krugman laughing in the background.
And then the United States, after the war, didn't they like pay reparations to the Japanese to help them rebuild?
I think they may have.
Those dirty Japs, we got to beat them. Oh, and then we got to pay for all their shit to be rebuilt. So war's a boondoggle.
Well, yeah, but the same thing happened in Germany.
For human lives.
The same thing happened in Germany, though. You know, aside from Hitler and all the horrible things him and his buddies were doing, you know, Dresden got firebombed the same way that Tokyo did. Like, they were burning the crap out of that place and just like incinerating civilians, the U.S. government. But again, aside from the Jews that were literally trying to escape for their lives because they didn't want to be locked in the camps, the rest of Germany, did they run? Did they seek asylum somewhere else? Did they become refugees? No, they stuck it out, and the ones that survived rebuilt, and now Germany is once again a powerhouse. So, I mean, I can see that argument, but I think it's a lot harder to make when you're the one whose house is getting bombed. You know, when somebody's dropping bombs on your neighborhood, when somebody's firebombing your place, it's kind of hard to say, no, you shouldn't leave. You should stay here and put up with it and then rebuild afterwards. So, like I said, I can see the argument he was trying to make, but I just don't really buy it because, you know, it's, yes, are you possibly putting a burden on someone else by seeking asylum or trying to become a refugee to another country so you get absorbed into their system? Well, yes, but that's possible anywhere when if you're just looking to freeload off somebody. But anybody else who's just fleeing for their lives, more likely than not, would be willing to work to take care of their family because the whole reason they fled in the first place was to take care of their family. So they'll end up becoming a productive citizen of some sort, you know. So I don't really agree that, you know, you should be forced to stay and not put anybody else out, because most of these people had nothing to do with the fact that bombs are getting dropped on them in the first place. They had nothing. It's the state. Well, it's always the state. It's the state against the state, and the poor civilians get sucked up in the mess, and they're the ones who have to pay the price. So
it's like I was like I tell people, you know, if you're saying, you know, like in England right now, there's a huge backlash against Muslims, of just anybody that's Muslim, and they don't want them there. And, you know, they're saying go back home and stuff, and it's just like that average British person, I just want to pluck them up and just drop them right in the middle of Baghdad or somewhere and say, hey, why don't you live here for a few weeks or a month or so, and then come back to England and say, yeah, you should go back to that. Same way it goes with, you know, Honduras or Nicaragua or some of these really bad places in Mexico. I know Mexico is very class, you know, based area. You know, there's some areas that are like paradise, and then there's some areas it's like, holy shit, did a bomb go off here recently? So, you know, you take the person that's saying, you know, go back to Mexico, to a guy who's coming over here busting his ass, working and doing jobs that white people and black people won't do. You know, to me, you can just fuck off. Like, that's the only thing I have to say to you. You know, if anything, the Mexican indigenous people have more of a claim to this land than any white man does. So they, on top of that, you can doubly fuck off. And you can just tuck your dick up under your gooch and stick it right in your asshole and ride it on home. So, like, and it's not...
This is the politically correct episode.
And this isn't me, like, sticking up for a race or anything. This is me saying, like, you've got to take a lot of things into consideration. And if you don't want to help your fellow man, then you can't really expect anybody to help you. It's so funny that, you know, most people that are against immigration are mostly conservative, and they're really strong on family values and stuff. But yet, you know, when a fellow human comes along that needs help, oh, wait, you're the wrong color. Oh, wait, you wave the wrong flag. So it's kind of disheartening to think that they could have this huge contradiction in their life and they don't even see it.
Well, it's not just – well, that's because for them it's not just family values. It's their family values. Other people's families don't count.
Well, if you're a Christian, we all came from Adam and Eve, right? So everyone's our brother and sister, right?
Right.
I mean, if you're going to carry logical conclusions.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, we live in this, statist-infused society, you know, where there's, you know, arbitrary lines and flags and nationalism. And you know, as voluntarists, we don't recognize that. We just recognize human beings. But these people, they do. And they see people, you know, coming from this country with that flag. And they're like, no, you're not like me. You know, it's like this cartoon I saw of you see two armies, and one of them has a flag of a duck and the other one has a flag of a rabbit. and the people with the rabbit said, there can be no peace until they accept our rabbit god.
Yeah. You know? And it's the same thing. It's just how you're looking at it.
Yeah, it's really amazing. Yeah,
the shape of the duck and the shape of the rabbit were the same thing. You just had to look at it in different ways.
Yeah. I mean, it's really amazing how we shun those people because they fly a different, piece of fabric, or they were born in a different, geographical location, or they, practice a different religion, and they're like, what? Are they a different species? No, they're still humans. Oh, okay.
I think a lot of the fear, Danilo and Jeremy, I think a lot of the fear, especially in Europe, is that, white people are whatever, indigenous to that area, Spanish, French, German, whatever, they're going to get culturally phased out by immigration. And, these huge central banking cartels are the main problem behind all this when you really break it down and see what, how everything's going. But, I think it's inevitable that, maybe in 1,000 years, 50 years, 100, not 50, but 100, 200, 300 years, everyone's going to have probably the same damn skin color, and we're all going to be speaking the same language. Yeah. So,
that's when we go on our way to our gray bodies and, join the alien races, everybody becomes one. There's no more sexes. There's no more, we're all just gray amorphous blobs.
And
screw languages. We'll all be speaking through telepathy and stuff like that. So
it's singularity will happen. Muslims shoot themselves in the foot big time when they get into almost every large mass immigration shoots themselves in the foot by not adapting to the area. The people that leave California and move to Texas, they get to Texas, they're like, this isn't anything like California, we gotta raise the taxes, we need all this bullshit stuff, I need counseling for fat lesbians and stuff. So people in Texas are like, why are you here, get the fuck out. So it's the same thing's happening in Germany and in Hungary and in Greece and stuff. You got all these people coming in from God knows where, not Somalia, Palestine, everywhere around there. They come there and they go, hey, we want Sharia law. We want to be governed by our own laws. And it's like, well, hold on a second. We're the protection racket here, not your religion. So we're going to have a little problem here, buddy. So it's same thing that happens with the Mexicans. The Mexicans come here, they take over a town, and everything gets put in Spanish. So people get upset about that. You go to Deerfield, Illinois, and they got Sharia law there. If you're a Muslim, you go to Muslim court there. You don't go to American court unless it's a federal offense, I believe. So it's shit like that makes people more xenophobic. It pulls them away. It's like, whoa, hey, this is changing way too fast for me. So I don't know, man. It's a mix between a lot of things, but I think what it is tradition and religiosity and just nationalistic pride gets driven into people's heads so hard that even when they leave those areas, they take it with them, and they try to change everything. Talk to a liberal, they're like, oh, we need to be open for multiculturalism. Okay. Well, when a Muslim area when an area gets taken over by Muslims and now you're having to wear a headscarf or you get beheaded or stoned, call me later. And I know that's a conservative, right-wing position to hold, but you can't expect someone to move into your area and wants to change the courts and the laws and everything to fit their belief system and not realize that, hey, that's a bad thing for me. But you also don't realize that the government that is currently doing that to you is also a bad thing, if you get what I'm saying.
Well, it's a cultural thing, and it's not, you always hear the stories about, assimilation and how people wanted to, the conservatives mostly, it's like, oh, yeah, we don't mind immigration, the immigrants, as long as they assimilate. But as you said, David, it almost never happens. I mean, you can look at Mexico itself. The USSA has been functional for what, 240 years almost or something as an official country. And Mexico has been down there the whole time. And in all that time, people have crossed the borders back and forth. But has Mexico itself become any more like the United States? No, because they have their culture. Mm-hmm. For the most part, they like it, and they want to keep it that way. So that is why when they do come over, they're, you know, the ones that do it the quote-unquote legal way are usually more willing to learn the language, follow the rules, kind of fit in. But even a lot of them still, like, you know, it's the same thing with any class of immigrants, you know, like, you know, here in New York, you know, you have Chinatown, you have Little Italy, you have all these sections of, you know, and it happens in a lot of the major cities where it's just, it's more comfortable for people to be around, you know, familiar surroundings. So if you move to a brand new country and you don't know anybody, or you only know a couple of people, are the majority of people going to want to stick themselves in the middle of some place where they know nobody and just try to figure it out? No. The majority of people are going to want to feel some level of comfort. So you're going to pool together with like-minded people, people from your culture, people that you know, either literally speak the same language or, you know, abstractly speak the same type of language, you know, type of thing. So that's what happens. And people, they... You know, it's weird because, you know, the term xenophobic gets thrown around a lot. And I don't think it's the case for everybody, because many people, you know, like here in the States, are concerned about the welfare state and people coming in. And you're seeing that now with all these other places, because like with Germany is pretty much controlling the EU. They have been since the start. And they are the ones who are accepting a lot of these new batches of refugees. I think I heard that Merkel, the chancellor over there, said that the country would be willing to and can financially absorb up to 800,000 more refugees. You know, that's a lot of people. That's almost 1 million people. Now, this is her saying it, and this is the German government saying this. But what about the people there? Are the people that thrilled about the idea of all these people coming in, and not necessarily out of fear of, you know, the scary Muslims or anything? Just the fact that, yes, it's going to make looking for work harder. It's going to, you know, put a drain on the tax system they have over there. So it's like, you know, again, it goes back to the states, because that's where all these problems come from. It's the state. They create these problems, and then they attempt to fix the problem they created by making the problem worse. I mean, that's a long-running theme in our show and a long-running theme in the history of the state. That's just what they always do. So
government tries to put out a fire with gasoline most every time.
Well, yeah, and plus they're the arsonists to begin with. That's what makes it even worse. It's one thing to pick up the wrong implement to put out the fire, but it's a whole other situation when you're the one who lit the match in the first place. You know, so that's the problem we have.
And then you blame the free market.
Well, here's the thing.
It has to be the market.
Well, of course, it's always the market or the evil capitalist, right. Which are actually mostly fascists. But Peter Joseph's going to be right, you know, computers are just going to run everything, and we're going to live in a post-scarcity society, right? So none of this immigration will matter, right? Right, Danilo?
All right. I wanted to go back to Jeremy's topic. You were talking about culture and how their culture didn't change even after centuries of, you know, moving back and forth between their geographical regions. And mm-hmm. that's a really good point. And also the fact that people associate their culture with their government, right? And that is one of the greatest non sequiturs that there is, that people say without the government, we would be back in caveman barbarism, you know, sticks and stones time. You know, we would lose all, you know, language and philosophy and intelligence and achievements, because that was the government that gave it to us. But,
well, you know, philosophy only comes from government.
Well, of course, political philosophy, but yeah, you know, those kinds of, you know, cultural achievements, you know, happened over, you know, many hundreds and you know, thousands of years of people, you know, interacting, voluntarily trading, and, you know, moving back and forth through different, you know, different geographical regions and different cultures, and And that has absolutely nothing to do with, you know, the gangs of killers, thieves, and murderers and liars that is composed of the government of that region. You know, it's really amazing. Like you mentioned, Angela Merkel. You know, she's saying we can absorb. Who cares what she says? I mean, she's not gonna be doing I mean, I guess they're gonna, you know, if you're talking about welfare, sure, she has something to do with that, but. But really, I mean, those people come, you know, and they're going to, like you said, I think they're going to work, they're going to contribute because they're concerned about their own welfare and their own family, and so they want to make a life for themselves. So
what an arbitrary number to 800,000. Like what
I know, how did you get that? Like how did she get that?
What happens
number?
When the 800 right. and 800,000 and one person
then
walks
she, then she pulls the gun the out. World. She pulls the gun.
Yep. No. Sorry. Turn around. Gates closed.
Yeah, this is a private club now. We don't see your membership card. See ya. No, like Danilo, like situations like this where you have a leader that comes in like Angela Merkel, like Barack Obama, like anybody else that just wants votes. And when you say, hey, yeah, we'll let you come in and we'll make you a natural citizen, whatever, just remember who did this for you. It was the Democrats or it was the...
You didn't build that.
the Labor Party or whatever the hell it is in Germany. I don't know or care. But what happens is you have this blowback by all the other citizens that have been there for decades and decades and families and, you know, generations. That a fascist, a hardline fascist like Hitler, like Mussolini or Churchill or anybody like that can come in and go, hey, I'll fix this problem and I'll get all these people out. And that leads to even more tyranny and more hot potato with all these people's lives. Whereas if there wasn't borders and everyone wasn't being dominated by some ruling class, this problem wouldn't be happening. There would be a migration of people around the world moving to where it is most advantageous for them.
Yeah, they would, but that's, you know, that unfortunately that's what you get back to that position of, well, yes, for people like us, you know, open borders or no borders is the ideal, and that's what, you know, we would see as being beneficial to everybody, because exactly like you said, everybody then has the opportunity to move wherever they possibly want, where they can set up the best situation for them. But, you know, unfortunately, from the pragmatic side, well, yes, this is the reality we live in right now. Right now, there are borders. Right now, there are violent protection rackets all over the world. With their own arbitrary edicts, with their own ridiculous immigration laws, and almost every one of them has some sort of welfare state built into them. Mm. So, you know, another thing I heard on the Tom Woods episode that I listened to, which I will be linking in the show notes because it was a really good episode with Danny McAdams, was the fact that, you know, I don't know the exact phrase, but the most centralized libertarian position, I guess. The most libertarian position would be no borders, you know, no force, any of that stuff. But when you're dealing in the reality that we live in, you could say let's not necessarily toss the borders out altogether, but let lessen the laws, let the immigration, let the migration happen. But all of these people that come in now do not get anything, you know, no welfare, no tax breaks, none of this stuff. And, you know, obviously for people like us, we want the welfare to be gone altogether. But in the interim, until that happens, it would make the most sense to just let the people in, but don't give them anything.
But how are the Democrats going to get votes then?
Well, exactly. The Democrats won't go for that. And I would honestly... as almost like a thought experiment, I would really like to see a lot of the conservatives, the Tea Partiers, even the neocons, how they would react to that actually becoming a reality. Because a lot of them talk that game. A lot of them say, oh, I don't have a problem with immigration. Oh, I don't, you know, because they're used to defending themselves from the claims of racism or the claims of xenophobia, which I can understand because I was in their position at one point. And I get that. I mean, I think we've talked about it once before. I actually, one of the last pieces I wrote before I fully accepted the inevitability that I was an anarchist, when I was still clinging to minarchism, one of the last articles I wrote was about the immigration, and I wrote it as I considered myself a libertarian, I considered myself a minarchist, but it was like pure neocon drivel that I wrote, and to this day I keep it just because I want to beat myself over the head with it every time I read it. Like, I want to make it into a book just so I can hit myself with it. I'm like, I can't believe I said this stupid shit, but I want to see if I would really like to see, you know, because a lot of them talk that game. They say, I don't have a problem with immigration. It's the welfare state. If they don't get anything, they can come on in. Well, I'd like to see that happen and see how many of them are still okay with that. You know, if they're just blowing smoke.
A new poll, I can't remember where it came out of, the most important topic in this election coming up is immigration by 80% margin. It's the most important by the closest topic is 20%.
Well, thank you, Donald Trump, because, you know, if it wasn't for him, nobody would be talking about it.
Well, I think a lot of people are upset about it, and it is. If you're a taxpayer, you can only be upset about this because, you know, reports are coming out that 50% of these people are on welfare. You know, half of them don't, you know, they'll get four or five Social Security cards. You know, I know some people that are on three or four different kinds of welfare on three or four different kind of names. So it's,
well,
you have this huge thing where it's this huge system that's built up on lies and lies and lies, the welfare system. Oh, we're just going to do this and you can opt out. Oh, wait, you can't opt out. And then this program, oh, you can opt out. Oh, wait, you can't opt out. This program, oh, yeah. And then you build that up and then you say, okay, we're going to stop immigration. But they're not really stopping that unless you're coming from the north down, because Canadians – if they're rich enough to move to America, aren't going to vote Democrat. They don't give a shit about Democrats. They're going to want to vote for the least amount of taxes, because the only reason you would leave Canada is to get less taxes. So, wow. Or a job or something. But, you know,
up until the ACA, they would also come in for better health care, because a lot of people are not as happy.
The ACA didn't socialize medicine. It made it more fascistic.
Well, no, I know that, but it's not on the level of how it is in Canada. But for all the talk, like all the single payer idiots out there that swear it's the answer, they look at places in Canada and go, look how great they're doing. Mm-hmm. And then you talk to some Canadians, and the ones that are happy about it never have to use the system. They go, oh, it's great, free healthcare. But do you ever, you know, how often? I never have to go in. Then you talk to Canadians who have actually had to use the system, and they're still thousands upon thousands upon thousands that are leaving the country to go other places to get procedures done, because you have to wait 6 months sometimes for an MRI because there's waiting lists for everything, because yes, oh, it's free. There's only so many freaking doctors. You can't get everybody to see, so you put people on waiting lists. And Pete, you know, I've heard some crazy ass stories about people waiting months on end for like what should have been taken care of in an emergency room that day, you know? So it's
you look at it like this, okay? You walk into an office building or whatever, and you got a little dish at the front in the receptions area, and it's free candy, it's free peppermints or whatever. And, you know, you go up and you grab a whole handful, because why the fuck not? It's whoever can get it, right? There's no limit. It's free candy. So if you put up a sign that says $1 per piece of candy, that's going to drastically limit how many people are getting candy.
Sure.
So,
unless you're diabetic.
Yeah. But then you're going to have the people saying, oh, that's mean. You can't be mean to poor people. They need their candy too. So it's this whole my feels versus what is moral. And unfortunately, people ride that elephant and they let the elephant take over, and the mafils wins over, and you keep these huge problems. Like I have a few friends that live in Canada, and they hate it. They hate this. So like a friend of mine, his mother would have died. She had to go to like Minnesota to get cancer treatment because it was a 2-year waiting.
Yeah.
2-year wait list for
yeah.
Molly came down to the States when he had cancer.
Right.
From what I remember, mm-hmm. You know, he talks about it openly. It's because it's not, like I said, that all the people that say it's a wonderful thing almost never have to use the system, or they only have to use it for like the bare minimum, which they are able to do relatively quickly. But for people who need the bigger things, it's not. But, you know, so like I said, I would like to see I would like to see something like that happen and see how many of the conservatives are actually true to their word about that. Because again, you know, when I heard that point raised on Tom Woods' show, at first it was like, well, no, I just want, you know, my thinking automatically was, no, I just want the open borders. But when you think about it, yeah, okay, if you want to let these people in and then not have them pay, or I mean, not have them receive anything. I mean, if there's a way to make that happen, well, let's try that and see how that works. And then we can hopefully try to work on getting rid of the welfare state itself, which is going
to
be
I would like to ask, like, one of these huge La Raza guys or whatever, these huge, like, big Mexican, like, you know, like, immigration, you know, all of them should have amnesty, all the. I would like to ask them if they would be okay is if they could not receive welfare benefits unless they've lived in the States for a decade and have been paying their taxes. What they would think about that, and I guarantee you not one of them would agree.
Nah, well, I think so. I think, again, I think, well, because there are people that do that. There are people that go the legal route and have been doing so for decades and come over, and they are forced to wait, you know, what is it? It's like 7 years or something to go through the process, at least it used to be, I think, something like that.
I think they've shortened some stuff.
Yeah, I know. They started to, quote unquote, streamline it. But I think it used to be something like 7 years until you could do. And a lot of those people were the ones that just really wanted a better life for their family. And they were they had to scrape up money. They had to beg, borrow, and steal money to pay the fees to do it the legal way. So they already proved themselves to be hardworking, or at least, you know, have the ingenuity to come up with a plan and do this. So once they came over here, they were like, hey, if I can get a job, I'll pay taxes and I don't care about receiving anything in return. At least not yet. I'll wait. So to say that none of them would, I don't think that's true, because I think, I mean,
I'm talking about the big supporters, the communist supporters, you know.
Well, no, okay, all right. So, anybody who is a hardcore commie probably wouldn't like that. But
most of those,
well,
community organizers are hardcore communists.
Well, a lot of the community organizers are just there to stir up trouble anyway.
Here's something I want to shift gears and help people that maybe are against immigration. The key to any fascist state is a strong border. That is key to any social fascist state, all right? Is keeping people out and keep people from leaving. you want your productive people to stay in, and you don't want anybody to leave.
Actually, that reminds me of a meme. You see Donald Trump, you see Bernie Sanders, and then Kim Jong Un. And it's like strong border, strong military, you know, strong welfare state, strong. You know, who cares about you the most? Kim Jong Un cares about you because he's got all of them checked off. I was at a park recently, and I saw a guy, Hispanic guy, with a shirt. It says, "It's like, relax, gringo, I'm legal." I just had to laugh because it's like people have this visceral reaction, you know, when they look at a Hispanic or any kind of immigrant. They're like, you know, are you legal or illegal? You know, are you contributing to our, you know, our government, our tax system, or are you just draining it, right? And what's amazing is they really have to understand, you know, the effort that they go through to get here, right? Like, I've talked to people who have gone, like, they pay like $10,000, right? They save up all this money, pay like $10,000 to get this, it's called a wolf, right? Like a lobo. And they come here, you know, either walking or by bus or like hidden on some kind of truck. And And yeah, it's just really amazing the amount of effort and suffering, and it's really dangerous. And a lot of them, you know, get assaulted and kidnapped and, you know, horrible stuff. Some of them die. It's like really, I mean, it's like amazing. Like you have to realize what is the situation that they fleeing from that's so bad that they really feel they have to get out of it, and they're going to go through whatever means necessary to get here. And then once they get here, people are like, are you legal? After all that, you know, and then they come here, and then they, you know, they contribute, they work in the jobs that nobody else wants to work, and you know, and then Americans are saying, you know, you're destroying our country. You're destroying our country by painting our houses, by babysitting our kids, by fixing our roofs, by washing our windows, washing our, you know, our houses. Like these are jobs that nobody wants to do, so what are you complaining about?
there was a watermelon farmer in Albertville, Alabama. There was a big news piece about it down here, and there was a bill passed in Alabama that was pretty heavy. Like basically, there was no, it took away any officers. They needed a, what is it called? When they can actually take and look at your papers. I'm drawing a blank right now for some reason.
Because they, well, in my experience, is just because they say so. There's no
reason. Well, no, like I smell weed, whatever that is.
Reasonable suspicion.
No. Yeah, I guess reasonable suspicion. We'll go with that. I can't remember the phrase. For some reason, it's drawing a blank. But Alabama passed HB 232, something like that, or 236, and it basically, if an officer thinks that you're an illegal, they can ask you to see the papers. Well, when they passed that, like, all the Mexicans moved out of a lot of areas in Alabama and quit working at the farms, and all these farms went tits up because
wow.
So all these farmers were trying to hire white people, and they're like, man, I can't get a white guy to come out here and do an honest day's work.
Right.
They were interviewing one guy that worked at a watermelon farm. He was white. He was like, I quit after a week, man. I couldn't keep up. It was just miserable. He was like 10-hour day working for nothing. It was just like, it's like, well, yeah. So why don't you go back to your trailer and go find your meth dealer and, you know, like, why don't you focus on that and let the Mexicans do the work that you won't do? And then you can sit in your trailer and watch Fox News and bitch about the immigrants all day long.
Dave, that's a good point, because to me that reminds me of the people who complain
and
about...
And I'm from Alabama, so I can make the trailer park jokes.
So it reminds me of the people who are complaining about, you know, buying stuff from like Vietnam and Cambodia and Thailand. Like, you know, that's promoting sweatshops, sex exploitation, you know, slave wages. And so those people try to buy it just U.S., and that's a good point you brought up, because even in the U.S., you know, people make, you know, off the books, right? They make very, very low wages, and if you're seriously thinking that that's exploitation, then you can't even buy from the U.S. It's just kind of an interesting concept that, you know, but yeah.
Ask a liberal what a low wage is.
Right.
I guess everyone should be making $50,000 a year with full benefits and a 401k. Yeah,
define a living wage, right?
Yes. Well,
and have a house paid for by the government and their school and kids paid for it. So it makes no sense. They don't think with their heads.
Well, of course not. but to get back something that you were saying a little bit before, David, it's funny, the, you know, with the situation that the Mexicans are coming over here to escape from. You know, a lot of people, again, unfortunately, I don't mean to keep picking on them, but like the conservatives and that side of the fence, you know, some of them are straight up just racist or xenophobic, and other ones are worried about the welfare state and all those things, which are legitimate concerns because it's the system that we are forced into at this point. You know, unfortunately, most of them agree with too much of it anyway. But, you know, we were talking earlier about, you know, the reason that the refugees are fleeing places like Afghanistan and Iraq and Syria and, you know, of course, the, you know, the dirty little secret that the U.S. government doesn't want to admit is the reason they're fleeing is, well, because we bombed the shit out of them.
Russia just built a bunch of bases and sent a lot of troops to Syria as well. So it's like, shit's about to go down there.
Well, that's the proxy war angle. But what I was going to say is, it's funny because most people would look and say, well, none of that happened in Mexico. It's just Mexico is, you know, it's overrun by the drug lords and they've got their own problems. Well, who caused those problems? Ding, ding, ding. Guess what? It was the United States fucking government again, because they're the ones who helped create the cartels. They're the ones who keep the cartels in business with their bullshit illegalization of, you know, the dangerous drugs. They're the ones who have fostered the cartels. They're the ones who have created that situation that the Mexican citizens are now fleeing from because their lives are in danger on a constant basis. Because, you know, something else you said earlier, Dave, about, you know, some places there are paradise. You know, you go to like Acapulco, it's still beautiful down there. You know, there's beautiful, big, beautiful vistas and houses all in the water. And then you go a little further inland and there's just these towns that are just, people are scared for their lives because it's either the police that are corrupt, you know, the federales, or it's just the straight up cartels that are running everything.
Did you ever see the movie Three Amigos with
yes, I love that movie.
Martin Short,
Steve Martin and Chevy Chase.
Yeah, yeah. El Guapo. It's like, yeah, you got all these towns with El Guapo rolling around killing everybody that won't pay him whatever, you know, he wants to be paid or make his drugs or whatever, you know, it's
Well, that's what I was saying, though. The average American would look at that.
The DEA needs the cartels to exist.
No, I understand that.
They have to have a boogeyman to fight.
No, I get that, but that was my point. The average American would look at, you know, even that you know, the satirical situation with El Guapo, or even just in general, and look at these type of towns and go, oh, it's their fault, or it's they have these bad people. You know, it's this, it's like the warlord argument in Somalia. It's all the warlords will take over. Well, no, it's not the matter that they were taken over. They were literally put in place by factions of the United States government. By, you know, whether CIA, the DEA, all of the, you know, they all had a hand in helping create this system that these people are now running from, which
and
makes
people
it even
know it's happening. They well, know no, it happened. No, nah, they do.
The
there's movies. There's
it.
Movies about it. Oh, the CIA is in here pulling their strings and stuff. Like
if
that's
a mainstream. If a
that's
mainstream
in the East Coast,
movie,
man.
If a mainstream movie has that type of stuff in it. Most people are going to think it's fantasy. Most people are not going to take it and look at it and examine it. People like us, like I know me, like I now go back and watch certain movies that I used to love and always, you know, always got enjoyment out of. And now I pick them apart when I watch them because I look at them through different eyes and I look at them from a, you know, from a voluntary perspective. And I look at them and I go, oh, wait a minute. There's some, you know, some stuff I didn't notice the first time around. But the average, you know, or stuff like that, I would see a movie like that and go, oh, of course, that makes sense because I know all the other history. But the average person looks at that stuff and goes, oh, that's just crazy. That's just the movies. They don't make the connection. Because if enough people did make the connection, they could help us put a stop to it. But these people don't realize that. I really believe that most of them honestly think this was a Mexican-created problem. And that's all the more reason to keep these people out. Well, it's because, well, they screwed up their own country. Now they're going to come screw up ours. No, your government helped screw up their country. And now half of that government is trying to act like they want to keep them out and they have no business being here, even though they were the ones who had a hand. You know, the Republicans, plenty of them were involved in all this stuff with the CIA and the, you know, the ones who have been there forever. They were all part of this. They all know what's going on. They all know they helped create this, but they'll go put on a face for their constituents and talk about we need to be strong in immigration. And it's not that we hate immigrants, but we need to, you know, cut the flow down and we need to stop. It's like, they're putting on an act because they know that them and their cronies were the ones that made this happen. So it's like, it doesn't matter whether it's bombs, whether
didn't they
it's
just
drugs.
Find a, didn't they just find a crap ton of cocaine on one of Mitch McConnell's boats or something?
I saw something about that, never bothered to confirm it because I honestly didn't care.
it's business as usual in the U.S.
Exactly. The hypocrisy.
I don't know where that came from.
There's my hypocrisy meter is broken when it comes to government officials because it's just, it's always, you know, whether it's the guy. I just saw another story. Somebody reposted a story. I thought it was a few months old, but it looked like it was a newer version of this. Some state senator, or maybe it was a federal senator, I don't remember, in somewhere, who got busted for doing, like, you know, having, like, performing gay sex acts or something, had been somebody who signed off on, you know, laws, you know, discrimination laws and stuff like that. So it's like the hypocrisy, it happens constantly with these guys.
You know what the most profitable town for escort services is?
D.C.
Yeah. You would think it'd be Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. Or like,
Vegas wouldn't, because Vegas has legalized prostitution.
So then it would be more lucrative if it's legalized. But no, in D.C., it's like straight up the most, in the whole world.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Like, because like all these senators and stuff, you know, they're not home; their wife's at home.
unless you're from Virginia or Maryland, or that one token person they have from DC who doesn't actually get to whose vote doesn't really matter. Unless you're in one of those surrounding states, yeah, you're traveling, you know, hours upon hours to get there. You're spending weeks at a time there. You're not, you know, some of them have second homes there, but yeah, you're right. Most of them, their families live back in their home states and they don't see them for months on end. So of course it makes sense that they would.
I remember when I saw a video on the housing crisis and when every other place in the, you know, in the United States, the housing value dropped, you know, just plummeted. Except in D.C.
Virginia. There's two or maybe three counties in Virginia that are the one that has Langley
in it.
Yeah, well, there's two or three of them that I think are the hot, like, you know, basically like the richest areas in the entire country. And they ring D.C. because it's all the people from K Street.
It's all the politicians. Just get the money out of politics.
The stupidity of that comment. I hate when people make that. It's like, what do you think that's going to do? It's not going to do anything.
Get the money out of politics.
It's impossible.
Yeah.
You can't get the money out of politics.
Not in a fascist state.
Politics is money. That's how it works.
They create their own money.
Yeah, they're the ones making the money.
I mean, if you wanted to get something done in England at a time, you had to pay off the king or one of his, you know, bureaucrats. It's the same. It hasn't changed.
Right. Yeah, well, see, it's funny you say that, because going back to Mexico for a second, when I was talking about, you know, with the federales or, the, you know, the corruption and stuff, that is the one bright spot, I think, about Mexico, that the federales, most of them, you can pay them off if they bust you for something.
Have you been watching Narcos on Netflix?
No, I have not.
Oh, it's really good. It's about Escobar.
Yeah, you told me about it. I don't have Netflix, so I haven't checked it.
I'll give you my info and stuff. Okay. But there's one scene where he's going up to a big checkpoint and he's got all these trucks full of cocaine and all the federales, you know, the it prefaces the scene. It's like, local guys, they're too scared to do anything, so we just throw them a little money. But the feds, they don't back down, and he walks up and he's like, oh, hey, Sergeant Ramirez, and oh, hey, how's your daughter doing? I know she's in eighth grade now and stuff. And it's like, are you going to let me go or what? And it was the famous line, silver or lead, you know, what do you want? Silver or lead?
Mm-hmm.
But this was Pablo talking straight up to the feds in Colombia. He was like, let me through or your entire family's going to die.
Well, yeah, but that's the cartel-ish side of it. But even the cops, though, that's the way they operate. They say, you know, they pull you over for like a traffic infraction or whatever the hell it is, and they will give you the opportunity to bribe them on the spot to get out of it. And most people are like, oh my God, that's horrible. It's corrupt. It's like, well, actually it's more efficient than our system. Cause in our system, you get pulled over, you get a ticket for an exorbitant amount. You either have to pay it, or if you want to fight it, then you have to take a day off of work, and then you have to go to court, and then you have to do all this other stuff. And like here in New York, they charge you fee upon fee upon fee. I mean, I think a seatbelt ticket is now, with all the additional fees, is up to like $240 or some crazy shit like that. But down in Mexico, you know, they have fines. They have a structure for that. But most of the cops are like, you give me some money right now, we make it go away. And people look at this, that's horrible, it's corruption. It's like, well, no, it's actually more efficient. And at least if I'm giving it directly to him, I know he's most likely taking it home and either spending it on his family or pissing it away on beer or something. At least it's not going back to the government to be used against the people.
It's robbing the government.
No, exactly. It's taking revenue away from the government. I would actually prefer to see local cops do that around here. And most people would freak out if I said that. But you know what? Hell, I would much rather pay a cop. I'd much rather hand a cop $100, $125, even $150 cash right there on the spot and say, we're good, right? And he takes it and tears up the ticket and walks off.
Yeah.
Problem solved. You know what? And I would much rather deal with that, because at least, like I said, at least you know that he's using the money directly. And yes, technically he may be extorting you at this point, but I'd rather him extort me and not be able to use that money against me versus the state extorting me and get to use that and get to use my own money against me at a later date.
Yeah, I was in Peru like years ago, I remember. And I remember taking a ride like over across the desert or something, or across the coast, and I fell asleep. And then when I woke up, my family members were like checking under the seats of the car vigorously, like, anybody got any money? You got money? You got money? And I'm like, what happened? And I looked behind the car as a police car pulled us over. Quick, get some money, quick. And then it was gone, done.
You know? Yeah, exactly. I mean, it can be scary. I mean, there's some horror stories that come out.
The cops down here now have credit card swipers on their – they have a digital ticketing thing now. So you can't – like if you get a ticket, you can't like call up and be like, hey, you know, could you please throw that ticket in the trash? Like that got done away with. As soon as they pull you over and you're getting a ticket, you're getting a ticket. But the state troopers, local cops still have to do a lot of the stuff that you can get out of. But, like if a state trooper pulls you over, that you can pay for the ticket right there. You can pay. Yeah. You don't even have to go to court or anything. Just pay for it right there.
Yeah.
Because they don't want you to go to court. It's like, hey man, if you pay this $80 ticket, you're going to save court costs and everything. And you don't have to ever see me again. So you can just pay this. And it's such a racket, man.
Well, it is, but because they know it works. Most people will jump on that and say, I don't have to waste any more time. I can get this done with. Okay, you caught me. Instead of taking the philosophy like somebody like myself, where I'm all about clog the fucking system. You get a ticket, you fight it. You fight everything. You make them work.
Well, here's the problem in Alabama.
And yes, it'll cost more. Well, okay, go ahead.
Here's the problem in Alabama. If you get a ticket by a state trooper, you have to go to the Montgomery County Courthouse, which is like 3 hours away from me. So it's like you either call it in and pay for your ticket over the – you don't go to court.
Oh, no. I get that. It's terribly inconvenient. It's the same thing if you get busted inside any of the New York counties. There's a chance that they may make you go into the city itself instead of, you know, if you're in Queens or something like that. So I get the inconvenience factor. But again, that's also done purposefully too. That's done so that because they know most people won't.
How is it? Is anybody else finding it quite ridiculous that in our beloved capital of Washington, D.C., that the marijuana is straight up legal there? You can buy it from a coffee shop or whatnot. But, you know, everywhere else, you know, a lot of other states is straight up illegal. And the same federal government that's based in Washington, D.C. will prosecute you.
Wow.
It makes no fucking sense. Like the laws in this country are so backasswards. It's not even funny.
Wow. None of the drug laws make sense, but that's a whole other story.
Yeah. So Jeremy, let me just tell you a quick story. Like years ago when I was in college, like, and this was way before I studied volunteers and anarchy and anything like this, Austrian economics, and I was just interested in in the system, and I would always go to court and just, you know, I just wanted to see it. And most of the time, if you go to court, like the system is so slow and it's like molasses that most of the time it just gets thrown out anyway. If you just like keep going, making court date, court date, court date, eventually it gets thrown out. Or most of the time the officer doesn't even show up the first time. It's like 80% of the time the officer doesn't show up. And actually one time I was able to pick the date myself of when my court date was, and I purposefully picked it November 26th, the day after Thanksgiving. I did that on purpose, and it was so awesome. I drove to the courtroom, and officer didn't show up. I'm like,
Of
that's
course.
the way to do it.
Yeah, they don't.
Did you see the thing about how to get out of any parking ticket?
Was that one of the ones that got floated on that new driver's license group that got floated?
No. Basically, you go to court and you just say, "Hey, if you can produce any physical
Oh
or
yeah. Produce evidence of of me actually doing this, and they can't. Unless the officer took a picture of your vehicle in its spot at that time, they have no way of proving that.
well, they have to have the picture of that, and they have to have the picture of your driver's license,
No,
or
I
not
know, yeah.
driver's license, but your tag and all that, and your
Yeah.
registration on the car and everything." And so it's just a bunch of bull, man. It's so funny. You can get out of any parking ticket.
If you're well, I mean, we're drifting away from the original topic, but I mean, to but well, we're famous for that. But if you wanna, if to stay on that for a second, if you wanna take the time, there's people, and I actually did see that in that one driver's license group that on Facebook that popped up recently. That's run by a couple of people I know. There's ways to get out of most of this stuff. If you're willing to take the time, if you're willing to pursue it, most people aren't. You know, I have a lot of my stuff on hold right now just because I've been avoiding them, and I just keep, you know, like I've mentioned before a bunch of times, my license is I think officially been suspended 3 or 4 times since January, but I just keep trucking along. I've racked up like a couple $1,000 in fines that they've sent to collections, and I've told the collection agency that I refuse to work with extortion agencies,
Wow,
so I'm not going to
nice.
pay them. And it gets them all flustered, and they hang up on me because I'm like, you know, you're dealing with a known extortion agency, right? And they're like, but, and then I explain the whole deal about theft, that, you know, how taxation is theft and all, and it blows their mind, and they get flustered and hang up on me.
Nice.
But there are ways to fight a lot of this stuff if you want to. But again, most people don't want to. Most people just want to take it and say, oh, it's,
Yeah, I just want to
you
put this
know,
behind
or
me,
yeah,
get
I
on with
just
my
want it over
life.
with. I don't want to, you know, because I mean, if again, I understand that because I've been in that position before. If you're somebody who works, who either somebody like myself who can't just take random days off, or even if you have paid days, like, do you want to waste a paid day of vacation or sick leave or whatever in order to spend an entire day at court? Or even worse, if you're somebody who has the ability to take the day off of work but doesn't get paid for it at all, are you really going to want to risk losing in court?
Well,
And losing a day's pay.
in my last job, if I got a traffic fine, if I fought it, I would probably would have gotten fired. I got one traffic ticket while I was there, and while in 8 years, I got one traffic ticket while in the company vehicle, and I just paid it immediately. Because, if I fight the thing, have to go to court and everything, that's going to show up on their data, their background check thing that they probably annually check backgrounds of all their employees, and so it was just not worth it.
Well, you don't have to worry about that. If it was a company vehicle, then they find out about it through the insurance. Because I had that happen to me before I started my business. When I was back when I was doing carpet cleaning, I got ticketed one day in the company van, and so the boss automatically found out about it because it went through his insurance. But luckily, it was his screw up because it was like registration or inspection or some BS that had nothing to do with me. But I got the ticket because I was driving the car at the time. But like I said, it's these things are set up to make it harder, make it. It's set up to incentivize people to just pay it and make it go away so
In
they
most
don't have to deal
corporate
with it.
jobs now, if you get a DUI, even if you beat the DUI, they still fire you.
Well, that I can't really take issue with, because if it's a private company, if they want to make
those rules, it's just still silly.
It sucks, but you know, from a voluntarist perspective, it's like, okay, it's private business, they can make the rules. You know, they are going to work within the system that is presented to them. So if these are the laws on the books, and most people look negatively upon DUIs, then yeah, I can understand why any private business would say, sorry, I don't want you, especially if it's a driving job, I don't want you driving for us because of this. Like, I get that. You know, the DUI laws are unfortunately ridiculous anyway, because it's, you know, for the most part, it's
Minority Report shit.
Exactly. It's thought crime shit. It's what could happen. You know, it's the same thing that happened when I got pulled over a few months ago that we talked about on the show, when I got the seatbelt ticket and I dropped the Minority Report line on the guy, because it was like, you know, his whole argument was, well, the seatbelt laws are valid because if you get into an accident and if you get launched through the windshield and if you happen to hit somebody else and injure and or kill them as you're flying through the air as a human projectile, then there's a problem. So it's like all these if because
you're punished for the future.
Well, you're punished because of the minute chance that all the stars will line up at the same goddamn time.
So
that's what you're punished for.
So right. to reel us back to our original topic of the show.
Drift.
I really don't see a end in sight or a solution for this problem that's happening in Syria, Libya, Palestine, Turkey.
Well, it's a status. Kurdistan, Iraq. It's a status problem. It's not a voluntarist problem. It's caused by statism.
I completely understand that, but I think what you're going to do is you're going to radicalize Germany, which we don't want to see again. You're going to radicalize a lot of the European Union, and you're going to force some kind of quasi super state over there. I guarantee you that's what's going to happen. They already had the euro, so why not just dissolve all the borders and just make one big massive super state, you know? the thought logic behind a union of nations or a union of states carries on to a world government. So, you know, at this point I'm almost like, why not just get the fucking show over with and have the world government? You know, I mean, and just watch humanity fall into flames, but that could be my nihilistic tendencies that you like to bring up.
No, I
really just don't see it.
This is Dave being optimistic.
I don't see a fix in sight for the Middle East until they run out of oil, until the rest of the world has no reason to give a shit about that area. And I honestly mean that. Like, you look at the only regime that's playing ball with the West is Saudi Arabia. And they're like the protected golden goose over there because they have all this oil and they can proxy war with Saudi Arabia and all this other shit. And, you know, as soon as someone comes out with an electric battery or something that lasts forever and is just as good as a gasoline engine, and I can put a solar panel on my house the size of an iPad and it charges my whole house, nothing's going to change in those areas, because you have all these situations where it's like the people are an inconvenience to these huge corporations. It's like if all these people just left and got the fuck off this land, it would be better for these corporations.
I would argue that technology probably has happened already, but it's been destroyed and silenced, and the person has been, you know, accidentally, you know,
murdered. It's sitting on a lock and key in some place like Langley.
Suicided, you know.
It's sitting in some big safe or something in Chevron or Shell's or BP's fucking corporate headquarters, and they're saying, oh, when profits really go to shit, we can just do this and then fucking, you know, move into the sustainable electricity or fuel or whatever game. I mean, they're going to milk that cow till it's dead. I mean, that it only makes sense. I mean, whenever you look at a market reaction to anything, you're going to see where there's a will, there's a way. The laws of supply and demand always rule supreme over every decision in any human's life. And so if you're a corporation and you're only beholden to your stockholders, you're going to do stuff to make sure that your profits never go down. And, you know, whether it's drone bombing a bunch of people to get them off land so you can drill, that's just going to happen. I mean, you can politicize it however you want, but that is what's happening in the Middle East. They're trying to get people fucking ducks in a row, controlled to where they're not messing with their money flow to get that oil out of those areas. It's the indigenous. It's like that movie Avatar. You know, like the evil corporation comes in to take over that area because they have that one material that everyone needs, and it's like, let's just kill all the people so we can mine this and not have any resistance. That's the problem with oil right now.
Actually, it reminds me of Bernie Sanders. You know, he's like, you know, we gotta rein in these evil corporations. And then as he saw an interesting meme today, is like, you know, evil government creates evil corporation. Therefore, we need more evil government to rein in evil corporation.
Well, the government is a corporation. So if Bernie Sanders is saying that he wants to rein in evil corporations, the most evil corporation in the entire world at this point has to be the United States government. And obviously he doesn't want to rein in any kind of government thing other than probably he probably wants to cut military spending to shift it to welfare.
Yeah. Well, I mean, to get back to
what you're saying. Which I'm all for.
Well, I'd like to see both cut, but you know, that's just me.
We as anarchists,
but you're just an extremist.
We as anarchists get tied up talking out of both sides of our mouths sometimes, where we're talking about the pragmatic, and the moral. Like, we all have the moral stance and what we would like to see happen, and then we have the pragmatic stance. And you know, it's hard. Giving up on some of your morals because you know that they can't be achieved.
Well, I don't know about that.
It's like being a martyr for the cause. It's like,
I think it'd still be pretty pragmatic to just cut both. Sure, we'd.
That's not going to happen. Even though we're
regardless of the
food stamps.
Yeah, but regardless,
it's still going to happen.
Regardless of what will happen or not, it's still a pragmatic approach. Because cut them both, and yeah, you may lose some people who just can't cut it, but you know, that's just culling the herd. Life sucks. Buy a fucking helmet, to quote Dennis Leary.
The largest race of welfare recipients in this country is white people. They're by far the largest welfare recipients. Not counting corporations that receive welfare benefits and stuff.
No. The agents of the state are the largest welfare recipients. All agents of the state, no matter of race, religion, or creed.
There's an agent of the state because they make the state money.
No, but I'm talking about the physical agents of the state.
Yeah.
There's military members.
I think
school teachers. But, well, hold on. Just to get back to what you're saying about the Middle East, I mean, yes, the oil situation does make things more difficult. But it's funny that you brought up Avatar because, well, I mean, yes, that was a movie, but what happened in the end? Well, the indigenous people finally stood up and said, we're not going to take this shit anymore. And they fought back and they won. And then they kicked the bastards out. Because that's what it's going to have to come to for these things to happen. Because all these countries keep getting taken over by the Western powers and they get bombed to shit. And then they have puppet governments put in place. And this has been going on for decades. And then when they get tired of dealing with one leader, they knock him off and put somebody else in place. And it's, yes, the oil definitely plays a huge role in this. But aside from that, this stuff will continue until the people in those areas have finally had enough and stand up and say, we're not going to take this shit anymore. You know, we're not going to take you just dropping new leaders on us. No, it's not going to happen. We can't, because it's just going to end. The same thing's going to happen over and over and over again. But unfortunately, so many of those people.
But Jeremy, you don't think it's advantageous for all the people in Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, you know, Yemen and all that to just sacrifice their lives so America can continue to be an exceptional country?
No, I do not.
With the cheapest oil in the world, you don't think their life is worth that?
I think it'd be much more advantageous for them to throw off the shackles of their government and then turn around and say, okay, now we own the oil. What do you want to pay us for it?
Well, that's what ISIS is doing. It's scaring the shit out of the West. They're saying, hey, we're going to print gold, coins, and look, hey, if you want to trade, if you want some of our oil, you got to pay us in gold. And if you've looked, every dictator over in the Middle East that has been killed and toppled, they followed that same pattern. Now, whether ISIS is a real threat to anybody or not, I have no clue. Whether they're an actual real, like if the CIA didn't make them, or Mossad or someone else didn't make them, that's another story. But the thing is, if a government over there, if a caliphate gets installed in Iraq and all of Syria, and they only accept gold for oil, they'll be the richest nation in the entire world. They really will. And Saudi Arabia and Yemen and Qatar and Iran would all probably super PAC with them, and it would be over. The West would go broke paying for gasoline.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's not. Yeah, you're right. It's not just about the oil. It's also about the petrodollar, right? And it's about the world reserve currency, right? And a lot of countries already have been rejecting the U.S. dollar, preferring to trade in oil, in gold, or in their own currencies, right? Bilateral trade agreements. So that I think is going to be a major blow to American imperialism. The oil is one thing,
it's quasi neo-imperialism.
It's
not necessary. Like, you know, if we're playing kings and gods or whatever, and I'm the king of the United States, there's going to be a United States flag on every Middle Eastern country, and I'm going to build military bases on every one of them, and I'm going to say anybody who wants to come take this oil from us is going to pay the ultimate price, and they'll also now be part of the United States. That's exactly how the game should have been played if we're looking at it from a imperialistic, I'm going to take over the world view. Mm-hmm. And they're not doing that. They can't do that because all these nations would rise up against the America. But when you ship us all together, you know, and you say, hey, you hold our hand, you know, hey, England, if you hold our hand through this whole Afghanistan thing, it won't be all on America. You know, if NATO holds our hand as well, you know, it's like getting as many people involved. So, you know, it doesn't look as bad, but it's all going to American and British oil companies, all these profits. Always has.
Yeah, but it's the long con that they're playing, because again, they've learned. The ruling classes in all the countries have learned from the mistakes of the previous ruling classes. And they have figured out that, you know, while somebody like Hitler came into power and took over and transformed his nation in relatively short order, he also burned out and fizzled out, and they got their asses whooped in rather short order, you know. So people have learned from that, and the US ruling class is great at that. They've been sitting back and watching this stuff happen for a couple of centuries now, and they've figured out that, you know, it's the frog in the boiling pot of water scenario, where it's, you know, you can't just drop, you know, you can't just storm over and take over the world and plant flags everywhere, like you were saying, because exactly, more people would be like, no, this is ridiculous, we're not taking this shit, and they would stand up. But if you do it slowly, if you do it through these, you know, nation building, democracy spreading, we're doing it for the good of the people. We're trying to help everybody and make it appear like you're the good guy. Then you can slowly chip away, and you can make these alliances and then break them later when you need to, and then make new ones and still keep building the empire slowly but surely. Because, I mean, there are bases in almost every single country, aren't there? I mean, what is it? Not almost 900 bases or something crazy like that?
Almost 1,000.
Yeah, I actually think I've read a couple of things that they have actually closed down quite a few, and there's not nearly as many, but there's still at least 700. Well, that's still a lot. There's only what? There's how many countries are there? There's 250 something like recognized countries, something like that.
187, I think.
Oh, maybe, okay, maybe only 187. Okay, so maybe I was over.
187.
All right, so let's just say 200. So, you know, 200 or less, and there's 700 or more bases, you know, like in all these places, and yeah, oh yeah, we're just there to keep the peace. I mean, please, there's still bases in Germany and Japan from World War fucking II. Why are they still there? More importantly, why do the people of those countries put up with these bases being there? And that's the thing that's the one thing that
free,
gets me.
Free protection.
You know, yeah, but most of them realize
it's like,
that
it's why
not
Canada doesn't
protection.
Have it's why Canada doesn't have military bases all along the border. It's because if you attack Canada, that's a direct threat to America, and you're gonna kick the beehive.
No, so, I know, no, but I'm not talking about the governments. I'm talking about the actual people. Like they, you know, even if they love their own government, like it always boggles my mind the people that the people here that don't have a problem with all these bases that look at it from that perspective. They go, oh, we're just helping out, or we're helping keep the peace. It's like
Team America.
Team America. But how would any one of them feel?
World police.
If all of a sudden they woke up tomorrow and there was a Chinese military base in their neighborhood, right. If there was a Russian military base,
yeah,
in
people
their neighborhood.
Would people would
like,
put
people
it
would,
up.
They would freak the fuck out. But it's always
American national would tannerite that whole.
it's the whole NIMBY attitude, you know, not in my backyard, that people take, that it's just. You know, and it's the collectivization of everything. I mean, going back to the original topic and something that was said earlier about, you know, people in England freaking out about the quote unquote Muslim invasion. And, you know, yeah, there's been some messed up stuff that's happened there. There was, you know, was it 2 years ago when there was that stabbing? There was a stabbing spree or something. There was a
beheading.
Bunch of people. No, it wasn't. Well, there was one. I think there was only one beheading in England, but there was Muslims running around, mm-hmm. in a small group of them.
All
you know,
it takes
small,
is one shot.
Is
Jeremy,
the Charlie Hebdo thing? You mean?
No, that was in France, but there was something in England. Where it was just like there's a small section in South London, I think, okay. that it started to get taken over by, you know, all these Muslim immigrants that were coming over. And there was a number, not a huge number, but there was a number of like radicalized ones that were out in the street threatening people. And since nobody's allowed to own guns over there, these guys are running around with knives and just stabbing people randomly. So, yeah, I get it why you would be scared of that. Mm-hmm. But it's the collective guilt thing where these people look at those incidents and go, oh, we got to stop the Muslims. We can't let any of the Muslims in. They're all horrible people. I mean, we see it here too, like the, you know, the Islamophobia, where, yes, there are Muslims that have done some bad things. There are also a lot of Christians who have done some bad things. There are some Jewish people that have done some bad fucking thing. Like, but it's automatically to make life easier. It's the collective guilt. Oh, we just got to keep them all out. They're all bad. Or you know, they're not the quote unquote good ones aren't standing up for the bad ones. So they're all bad. So it's like, okay, do you really think all of these people are a threat to you?
How many Americans were in the streets rioting because we dropped bombs on Nagasaki and Hiroshima? That was one of the biggest acts of terrorism in the entire world ever that has ever happened.
Mm-hmm. Not well, one of the, yeah, but not even close, because I touched on that a little bit earlier. The firebombing of the firebombings of Tokyo actually killed more people than both of the nuclear bombs combined. The fire bombings of Tokyo killed over 100,000 people. Hmm. And that happened before the bombs were dropped. Because each bomb only took out, what, like 50 or 60,000 people, I think, something like that. The fire bombings took out more. The fire bombings of the president took out more.
Where were all the moderate Americans speaking out?
Out in the streets cheering is what they were doing.
Exactly. So it's like,
but
you know, shut your fucking mouth. That's all I want to tell these people. Like, just use your brain and shut up. Well, like the moderate Muslims in these areas, you know, I've got a few friends that have went to Iraq and Afghanistan, and they'll fucking tell you, if they see your family talking to an American military member, their entire family's heads will be on sticks in the front yard of their house the next day.
Yeah.
So it's like, where are the moderate Muslims? Oh, they're keeping their fucking mouth shut because they'll die if they don't.
Exactly.
And the radical ones will either flip on their brothers and join the other side, or they'll die. And then you mix this with most, you know, there was this thing, they went to Yemen, some BBC reporter went to Yemen and was asking all these people, hey, have you ever heard of Al-Qaeda? And they're like, what the fuck is Al-Qaeda? And then, and there was just people after people after people. They were asking little boys. They were asking little girls. They were asking old people, is Al-Qaeda have you ever? And they're like, what is Al-Qaeda? It wasn't like, let me go over here and talk to this person because I can't speak about Al-Qaeda. It was, what are you talking about? There's no such thing as Al-Qaeda.
Yeah, you know, going back to the military bases, I remember a picture of, you know, you see Russia and you see all the military bases around the border of Russia, you know, all the countries there, you know, Ukraine and the Middle East and all the Eastern European countries. And it says, look at Russia. They put their country so close to our bases.
They're begging for it, man. They want us. They look at them. Yeah, they're asking for trouble.
It was Iran, and there was bases all around Iran. It was like, look at these asshole Iranians putting their country right beside our bases. Right. They're asking for it.
Yeah. And Jeremy, to go back to, you know, you're talking about the movies and about how they do show that you know, the CIA is behind a lot of this stuff and the FBI and the DEA, you know, with the drug cartels. And it's funny because people go there and they watch that, and it's like entertainment. It's like, wow, look at that, it's amazing. And then after they come out, they're like, all right, so I gotta go to bed, get up early for work the next day. That was a good movie, nice movie you saw. And that's it. That's the extent of their interest in you know, global affairs, whatever is happening.
Well, just Kermit, there's a guy named Kermit, I can't remember his last name. Is it Roosevelt?
I don't know.
He was like director of the CIA or whatever, or before the CIA was there, he was there. And he was there. He was one of the main people that toppled the Shah of Iran. God, I'll find his name and send it to Jeremy so he can put it in the show notes. But, you know, like, they didn't want Iran there because the American and British petrol company was having problems with the Shah of Iran. They got the Shah in place. The government before them.
Yeah, they overtoppled him. They put in the Shah, and then they turned around and toppled him, what, 30 years later or something?
Yeah.
Toppled him 20, 30 years later because he stopped playing ball with them.
Yeah, because, you know, there was a leader in before that basically socialized all the oil in Iran and was like, hey, you know, whatever the government makes on the oil for this area, we're just going to give. After we pay all of our bureaucrats that handle that and all the people that are working in the oil fields, we're just going to give everybody money from this and free gas. And, you know, the BP at the time, that was the company, they rebranded to BP, but before that was the India something petrol company. I can't remember the name of it, but I can look it up. They were having problems. They were getting kicked out of Iran, and they were like, hey, this is too much money we're losing. We got to get back in Iran, and they called it in the United States. Boom, and it happened. So, you know, that it's oil, and like I said earlier, when oil is no longer a point of focus for the whole world, those areas will kind of it'll be like, okay, what the fuck? Oh, some Muslims are blowing up other Muslims. We don't care.
Well, I don't know. See, I don't know. I don't see it getting to that point. I think everything will either. I think the New World Order will either be ushered in, or the entire world will collapse before people actually run out of the need for oil. Because unfortunately, you know, as we kind of alluded to earlier, there's a lot of things that have been, you know, we've discussed it before. There's a lot of stuff that's either been rumored to or has been now proven to have been held back by the state. Inventions, you know, innovations that are either not allowed to take place or, you know, hindered in some way because of the state.
It's a lot of that before the internet, though. It's really hard to do that now.
No, well, yeah, it's getting easier, but we're still a long way off because, you know, you get the environmentalists and stuff that are all anti-oil and all anti the renewable resource, you know, the whatchamacallit, all the fossil fuels and stuff.
Why aren't they putting their money where their mouth is and donating to, you know?
Well, some of them do, but that's not the point. They're all screaming about solar and wind and solar and wind and solar and wind. It's like, yeah. In theory, it sounds great, but they don't bother to look at the numbers. And number one, how much it costs to build all of this equipment, number one. Number two, where does a lot of the equipment and pieces they need come from? Petroleum. You need petroleum to make these products, to make these solar panels, to make these wind turbines. Like, you still, it's still a product that is needed. And because these programs have been stunted by the state through onerous regulations, through the crony capitalism and fascism that has kept certain people out of the market altogether, or has kept certain ideas out of the market altogether in order to keep the existing structures propped up, there are all these, there is this backlog where solar and wind probably could be 25, 30, maybe even 50 years advanced at this point, where it may not need as much of this stuff, where it would be more cost effective to put these systems in and try to generate energy and try to get off the, you know, the need, the as much need for oil. But because these things have happened, we are still at a point where it's still ridiculously expensive to install these systems. So you're not actually saving any money. The person, you know, the individual is not saving any money. So there's no incentive for them to do it, you know, in the first place. And you're not really lessening the need for oil and gas, because these products are still being used. You know, like here in New York, they're so, you know, the government's so proud to announce that they're, you know, get solar, we'll help you. Yeah, they'll subsidize you. Right. They'll steal money from the entire population of the state to turn around and give you quote unquote free or reduced priced solar panels, which is supposed to save you money, but again, you're not actually if you don't have to lay out for it. Well, you're laying out for part of it because your taxes are paying for some of it, but so are your neighbors. And if your neighbor has no interest in solar panels, he's still paying for yours anyway. But like, and people jump on this like, oh great, it's, you know, I'm helping the environment. I'm like, you're not helping shit. All you're doing is helping perpetuate the system, because again, it takes, they have to steal money to give money away to get the money back, and it's just a vicious cycle, and it's not getting anywhere. And you're still like, I mean, the only, you know, good idea I've seen when it comes to that is, I actually have it, somebody, I think my dad actually sent me a disc on it one day. I haven't got around to doing it, but I have a DIY solar panel kit that you can make out of soda cans. You can literally crush aluminum cans down and build a solar panel out of that. You know, it just takes a lot of time and effort, which I have not had. But like, if you're going to do that, then yeah, great. Then you can actually say that you're saving something, because you're recycling your own old material and you are generating energy that way. But even still, like, all this talk about it, it doesn't generate enough power to supplant the need for oil and gas and coal. So these things are going to be around. So they are, yeah, like I said, I don't think.
Did you read about Australia? They're the first nation in the entire world to have 51% of all their national power come from solar panels. But you know, in Australia, you have all, like, half their country is a desert.
Well, yeah, half its desert. They're closer to the equator. They're and they have a lot less people. It's not. It's something that's not. You know, it's the same idea, but behind, you know, the ANCOMs. When I tell them that, yeah, I have no problem with you trying communism, because I think it would work in a small setting. On a larger setting, it won't. So yeah, solar. You may be able to supply solar energy for a small population, but when you get into a population of 300 million people or more, it doesn't work as well, because the technology is not efficient enough yet. Mm-hmm. It's not.
I think we should just
cost effective enough yet.
Here's what I think we should do. I think we should just nuke bomb the entire rainforest and put up solar panels and wind turbines.
There you go.
You think that would help?
Sure. We don't need all that pesky oxygen that the trees help create. We don't need that.
No, that's all bullshit, man. Most of the oxygen is made on the ocean with the algae.
That's not bullshit. That's what that's how,
like, 10% of the oxygen that in the Western Hemisphere comes from the rainforest. The rest of it comes from the oceans.
I wasn't talking about just the rainforest.
I was just messing with you.
I'm just talking about plants and trees in general. So yeah.
Oh yeah, cut down all the trees and make Bibles. Easy.
All right, so I think we'll start wrapping it up. So give your final remarks on immigration and.
Oh, is that what we were talking about?
Fun. Right.
I thought we were
fun
talking
solar about panels.
I thought we were talking about oil. I thought
we were talking about corporate fascism. I could have swore that was
How to get out of a police ticket? But it's funny, Jeremy, when you bring up the alternative energy thing, because it's such a an attractive idea for so many people, like free energy, look, there's sun, it's free, and you're right, oxygen is all around us, nitrogen is all around us, wind is all around us, but again, if you don't have the technology to harvest it, it's useless, right? Like oil has been in the ground for, millions of years, right? Slowly compressing and through pressure, that's how it's formed. And for what, like 100 years, 150 years, that's when we've started using it. And how was the standard of living before that? It was horrible, right? We could barely get past like a billion people on Earth. We were struggling. And now, now that we're able to harvest that and use it and refine it, it's really catapulted, the wealth in society and standard of living. So people tend to vilify oil, but then again, really compare it to how we were living before, and it has really produced a civilization that can survive, that can support 7 billion people and growing, mm-hmm. right? So the fact that the sun is everywhere, sunlight is everywhere, air is everywhere, good, okay. But if you don't have the technology to use it or harvest it, it's useless, Put on your sunscreen, put on your sunglasses, that's all. You can't use it for energy. So shut up, relax, okay? Stealing money from other people is not going to help the problem. Okay, if you can find out a way to make technology to harvest the sun, all right, that's cool. There's no theft involved in that. But if you think stealing money for your neighbor so that you can afford something to put on your roof that you think is going to, make you feel, it's more like a selfish thing. It makes people feel better, and I'm like.
I drive a Prius.
yeah. And it's so funny. Like, actually, bring up my mother real quick. She's very proud to tell me that she's going to get solar panels on the roof of her company. And of course, it's going to get subsidized, right? And I'm like, and she's so proud. And the first thing that I said is if you are really passionate about solar panels and you really want to get on the roof of your company, on the roof, pay for it completely yourself, okay? Because if you do that, I will believe how passionate you are in supporting these companies. If you don't do that, you're just robbing other people. You're just taking other people's money, and there's no virtue in that. There's no morality. There's no honor in that whatsoever, right? That's dishonorable. That's theft. and so I think people, tend to. There's like so much theft going on, so much taxation, these people getting robbed, we're all getting robbed. You know what? It's all right. The oil companies, they get subsidized. Let's subsidize the wind companies and the solar companies. Let's just add more to the pile.
And they're absolute failures. Most of the companies that all these subsidies are going to, it's like some senator's wife or the president's cousin or
Solyndra, baby.
Yeah. It's like, wait a second. That money's going right back into the politician's hand.
Right. So basically my message is that, all this stuff is available and is ubiquitous and is around us. But again, if the technology is not there to harvest it, to refine it, and to use it as energy, then it's fundamentally useless and it doesn't exist. Basically, oil basically did not exist before people could access it and refine it and use it. And then it catapulted, civilization.
That damn John D. Rockefeller.
Right. So, yeah. That's my
I'll leave you guys with this. I am anxiously awaiting for our robot masters to take over. That is it.
Arnold Schwarzenegger, where are you? Come back from the future.
I'm ready.
Well, I guess I'll go back to our, I'll be the one to go back to our main topic just to finish this off.
Traitor.
We need tangents. Tangential, like railroad. Okay.
I think we've had enough of those tonight. to go back to the original topic about the refugees and stuff. I mean, all the stuff we have talked about does relate to it in some way. But you know, like I said earlier, it's
maybe not parking tickets, but okay.
There's I'll find a way to link it. Hold on. there are these people. They are fleeing. Instead of either automatically assuming that you must help them, and when I say you, most people, when they think, oh, somebody has to help them, oh, let's let our government help them, which means money will be stolen from my neighbor to help these people. Instead of thinking that automatically, or instead of thinking automatically, well, we don't want these people here, we need to keep them out, try to look at their situations and ask yourself why they are leaving. Why are these people coming here?
Sorry to pull you into this, but couldn't Germany just sign a treaty with Syria and say, hey, look, we're going to come to the defense of Syria if any outside nation tries to make a military presence here, basically declaring war on the United States?
They could, but they won't, because Russia...
That would fix the problem.
Russia already has that agreement, though, so they're not going to... You know, it's all juggle... When it comes to that, it's all the juggle for power. You know, friends become enemies, enemies become friends. This is a cycle that's been going on forever. At some point, they may. I don't know. But right now, as far as I've gotten into it...
It sure would stop that 8,000 on the dot. Refugees coming over, right?
Well, yeah, maybe. But they no, but again...
Just 8,000. Well, stop them.
800,000. Get it right.
My apologies.
Those zeros count. Come on.
Yes. But anyway, so look at why these people are doing it. And, you know, especially if you're somebody who's here in the States, you know, take a long, hard look at where, like I said, you know, I'm going to link to that Tom Woods episode, you know, and you can fact check Daniel McAdams and his stuff. But, you know, because I looked into it after I heard it and I found the same type of numbers. You know, the same three countries keep heading the list for the past few years, and they are Iraq, Afghanistan, and Syria. And the one thing that links all three is that they have been either invaded, occupied, and/or bombed by the United States government and its allies. So that's why the majority of these people are fleeing. Now, I understand the fear. And I've seen some stories where there are supposedly known terrorists that have been seen trying to become refugees. And like they have pictures of some guys. Like I saw one, there was one guy, they had a picture of him as part of the, Al Nusra Front? Is that what they call it? One of the offshoots? They have a picture of him with a group of those people. And then it appears to be the same exact gentleman now trying to get himself into Germany as a refugee. And there's stories like that. So yes, there is a fear there. And a completely open immigration policy does run that risk. But again, you have to look at why those type of groups were created in the first place. Because many of the terrorist groups that you're always told to be afraid of were either created directly by state intervention, or they are a result of state intervention.
Blowback, baby.
And that, exactly. And that's why, so it's like, yeah, you're afraid of what these people are going to do now, but look at what made them. Look at what created this to happen, you know? And the same thing with the actual refugees, the people that are just literally running for their lives or their families.
This
you know,
is just America.
There's always going to be people that are looking for the free stuff. There's going to be those people in every culture that are going to try to take these routes to get what they think is free stuff. But on the whole, most of these people are just trying to either just survive or just try to make a better situation for them and their families. And instead of, you know, chastising them or, you know, trying to welcome everybody with open arms without thinking, you know, put a little thought into this and see why these people are running, instead of just look, because like a lot of the conservatives will look at the horror stories of, you know, what's gone down, like I was talking about earlier with the stuff that was going on in England a couple of years ago. I think the same thing has been happening in Sweden to a lesser extent.
It's happening in America too, where these Mexican gangs are just killing people, invading homes and stuff. So,
well, yeah, but again, you know, that's what people are always so afraid of, is, you know, the warlords will take over, or these bad people will take over. It's like, these people exist now with the state, and they are being helped by the state. So the state is the common denominator in all this. And that's what, you know, that's why we work towards that. That's why our end goal is to dismantle the state, because most of the problems we find ourselves in, or find the problems that we see, are caused by the state. So we're just looking to take out the big piece and let everything else fall out on its own. So, you know, it's like I said, it's easy to get swept on this, up on this, on either side. I think I just wish more people would look into this a little more closely, or look into it at all, because there's a lot of people here that have that, you know, the NIMBY attitude, where it's like, oh, what's going on over there? We don't have to worry about it. It's like, well, no, your tax dollars helped create a lot of this, and you're continuing to send in your tax dollars every year, so it's continuing to fund all this stuff. So you do play a small role. So if we want to make the world a better place, then you got to look at these things a little deeper.
Yep. 0110010001.
Exactly.
I'm learning.
All right. Well, awesome conversation. Thanks a lot, gentlemen. So if anybody, you want to follow us, we're on iTunes, Stitcher, Facebook, YouTube, and you can find all those on theseedsofliberty.com. And if you want to donate, you can go to theseedsofliberty.com, Patreon, or Bitcoin. We accept both, so throw us some Federal Reserve notes before they're completely worthless. So before the petrodollar gets completely shunned, you know, it's still worth something. Toilet paper is still worth slightly less, but until then, we'll accept Federal Reserve notes. So thanks a lot, everyone. So this is the Seas of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye.
Peace.
Bye.